I'm Dr. Kilea, the medical officer at Embangweni Mission Hospital and currently the chairperson of the COVID-19 Preparedness and Response Task Force. So it's there you have found us deep in our training. We are trying to give as much as possible knowledge to our staff, all of them, so that we talk the same language, we have the same weapons to fight this disease at our institution.
I understand you've got 4 health centers under this facility. How are you planning to make sure that each one of them is well equipped pertaining to readiness facing the COVID-19?
Okay, thank you for the question. Our 4 health centers, they are part of us and they have not been left aside. So in our plan, we included the nurses, clinicians, and even the HSAs and other supportive staff also in the training. So mainly nurses and clinicians from the health centers, they have been also invited to take part to this training. And apart from that, the few material we have managed to have. On top of that, we plan to give our health centers supportive supervision. That means upon we have given them the knowledge and provided what they need, we have also to be there with them time to time and see how they are doing and help them where they are not doing well, or encourage them in whatever they are doing well. And that's what we want. Because if we leave them alone, they may not know which point they have reached. So that's what we would like to see, that we are working hand in hand with our health centers.
So today, who are you training?
Today we are training technical staff like nurses and clinicians. Yes, and we include also some administrative personnel, because despite that they are administrative personnel, they come in contact with most of our staff here.
How prepared are you to face COVID-19 in the event of a case at your facility?
Yes, I shall say knowledge-wise, I can say we are enough prepared, because we have managed to talk, to hold health talk with most of our staff about COVID-19, to tell them clearly how this disease is transmitted and what is needed to avoid contacting it. Yes.
What challenges are you having currently that you would want probably people to come in and assist?
Thank you for the question. Basically, we have a very big problem with water supply at our institution. We have some pumps, but they are not strong enough, powerful enough to supply water to the hospital, so that we can have it for different services we are rendering here. And we tried to bring a tank where we can save around 5,000 liters, but unfortunately water supply from the main tank, that's the problem, because our pumps are not functioning. So how I wish that we had a strong, powerful water pump to solve this problem. Yes.
So much.
Thank you, Lord. And
we still need a helping hand from elsewhere. Like for example, here at Embangweni Mission Hospital, we are privileged to have this platform, the GeneXpert platform. This platform is being used for diagnosis of a number of problems, and the coronavirus may be one of them, because this platform may diagnose Ebola, may diagnose TB, HIV viral load, as well as early infant diagnosis HIV, even HPV. So currently here at Embangweni, we are doing EID, viral load targeted follow-up, as well as TB, GeneXpert on this platform. So having this platform here at Embangweni Mission Hospital, at least we have an upper hand that if we be given the necessary requirements for us to diagnose this coronavirus on this platform, I believe we are on the map to excel, just like elsewhere they are doing.
As a lab manager, what are the day-to-day problems that you do meet for you to carry out your proper daily diagnostic services for the hospital?
Oh, that's quite a good question. Our challenges are always there as far as our daily operations are concerned, one of which is the human resource. We are not enough lab technicians here at Embangweni Mission Hospital. This is a 24-hour service health service provider facility that opens or that operates in 24 hours, both day and night. Therefore, as at the meantime, we are only two of us, myself and my colleague. So for us to carry out all the required activities or tests that this hospital needs from time to time, it's really quite a challenge because of the few of us that are at the moment available. So for that, it's a problem. Number two is also to do with the resources, especially the lab reagents. Most of the things that we are using here, the hospital has to find money to buy them. So in times like this that we are faced with the corona pandemic issue, as well as we already have other issues that the hospital needs to take care of, it's really a hard time for them maybe to procure enough resources for the lab to keep running. So we may be asking for an upper hand elsewhere if the well-wishers be there to help us at least to have a smooth running of this hospital laboratory, considering the fact that this laboratory is most vital as far as disease diagnosis and prognosis is concerned.
Do you have a budget, as in how long, how much would you need in a month for you to have everything that you need to carry out your services, I mean, smoothly?
Yeah, but roughly, I may say in Malawi Kwacha, the services that we do provide here in a month time, for the smooth running of this laboratory, we may need not less than maybe 6 million in a month to cater for the services that we render to the community that do come here to seek for medical help from this hospital in Embangweni.
Okay. So that's around $8,000?
Yes.
Okay. So in relation to COVID-19, mm-hmm. You think you are ready, but the issue you have are supplies that you need in the laboratory?
Yeah, we need supplies. We need also maybe a further orientation or as far as to specimen collection, handling, and also testing itself is concerned.
Is water a problem?
Oh, here we are having a big problem with water. It's in the sense that one of our electricity generating machine at the river got broken, but also most of the times we run short of maybe units to run that machine to pump water to this far. As such, we do maybe last 3, 5, or 1 week or 2 weeks without water here in the lab. So for the smooth running of this laboratory, water is very vital because everything that we do here ends with water, because water is the cleanser. For this room to look tidy, it needs water. Without water, then the room will be dirty. Most of the tests also that we conduct here, we need at some point water to wash the waste matters. So water is very important, but we are having a lot of problems with water to reach this far because of the problem at the pumping site there. So if there may be that possibility that others may wish to help us at least to rectify that pumping action at the river, very, very important. We may appreciate the efforts they may put in.
Yeah.
understand you're the head of security and today you're on duty. How do you make sure that people who come in the hospital and also go out of this hospital are protected from possible COVID-19 cases?
Okay, thank you, doctor. As you said earlier on, I'm the head of the security, yes. When the people coming in, I try myself to stop them so that they should wash their hands frequently. They're coming in, also they're coming out. They should wash their hands.
What are you trying to protect?
I'm trying to protect the COVID-19 just because of most of the time COVID-19 people can spread through hands, through mouth, through nose and the eyes.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Passing through times of COVID-19, how are you making sure that you're protected from COVID-19 in this ward? First of all, you tell us who you are.
Alright. I'm Peda Gaunga, nurse midwife technician. I'm a nurse here in pediatric ward. Current of the issue of COVID-19, it's a bit challenging because we are dealing with the community. So we are trying to have control in people entering this ward because we have kids with different conditions. So we are trying to control people so that at least we should have minimum people in this ward, especially just a mother. But the community is itself is a very hectic one. That's why I can find outside we have many readies out there. Because they all want to enter, but at least they're trying to withdraw. We're also encouraging hand washing techniques. So we have a bucket, which is for this one. Soak there and water inside it. And we're also encouraging our mothers that early in the morning they should check the bare outside if there's water and refill. So that's part of our orientation. Whenever we admit the patient here, you have to orient them what we are doing here inside. You have to put off the shoes outside there, the shoes, make sure the bare outside, the water filling there, and the solution is soap. If the soap is not there, you should contact the nurse. In charge of the children to give them soap. That's how we are trying our recognition. On our side, we have to make sure we first mask when we are approaching a patient. Like here, you'll find us with the patient got admitted, so we have to put on gloves as well. Then we attend the patient. When we are done, we have to remove these gloves, even in the mask as well. This is just for some hours. Yeah, that's how we are doing our job.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Hello. How are you?
Fine, and you?
May we know you?
My name is Embangweni. I'm a clinician. Okay. Based in pediatric ward, as it is here.
Do you like your ward?
Yeah, I like
my ward. Why?
Yeah, because I like playing with kids, so okay. It feels interesting seeing them coming. Okay. Just within a short period of time, they are gone. Okay. You. So, it makes me happy.
And how prepared are you pertaining COVID-19 as a clinician of this hospital?
As a clinician of this hospital, apart from whatever the sisters were to say, concern ourselves with things to do with hygiene and protection. For example, I put on a mask. Regardless of the fact that this is not only efficient enough to protect me from anything, at least I'm protected. The other thing is, whenever we're here, we're coming, we're supposed to wash hands, particularly at the gate. We know that not everyone may have that access to have taken a hand wash somewhere else, but at least if you are here, you are at least assured that someone has washed hands. You come in the ward, you see a patient, you wash hands each and every patient you come in contact with. And mostly we emphasize on the 1 meter apart distance when you are seeing a patient. And the other thing is, whenever you are in contact with a patient, for example, when I'm examining as it is now, it's when I'm supposed to put on a mask mostly. So that at
not least, every time.
Not every time. So that at least I should be safe.
Okay. So how, is there anything else that you feel like as a team you would need in for you to face COVID-19 better?
Yeah.
What are things?
Mostly what would make me feel better that I would at least be safe in terms of COVID-19 should be issues with protection of generally the face itself. For example, we may need something to cover the face of the as a whole.
So PPEs?
Yeah, PPEs. Yeah.
Do you have enough oxygen concentrators?
No, currently we have 101, and that one is a bit of a challenge because sometimes we may end up having, we can have at least 6 children. So for us.
So you'd need 6 to be okay?
Yeah, at least 6 would be better.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Let me take a stick off.
Aha.
So may we know you and your position at this hospital?
I'm Andrew Zimba, the porter, head driver for the Embangweni Hospital.
We face fueling. We do get fuel at a distance using drums. We get fuel to Zimba, passing Toza in Forest to the Damak Road, the square filling station is. And another problem is outreach clinics, the tires, battery, and the distance of where we are getting patients of outreach clinic is distant. So fuel-wise, we do use fuel, too much fuel to the vehicle.
So what problems you say of your vehicles, because the roads are bad, then what happens?
We were almost suspension to the vehicle. It's long.
Okay. Fine. And you are Mr.?
I am Alex.
Okay.
Stores Craig. Yes.
Are you also involved in this fuel thing?
Yes.
Embangweni Mission Hospital. We have a lot of things which we do, but firstly I'll say we are organizing morning devotion each and every day at hospital so that all staffs should attend and worship God before they go for work. And also we do Bible study with the guardians and many of the expectant women come and stay here for a long time, so we encourage them with the word of God. And we also have a training on staff members, which is called saline training, whereby we train nurses
supported by
MBF. Yeah, so we make sure that they are doing their work holistically, meaning that when patients come into our hospital, they need to be helped physically as well as spiritually. So this program is done through saline training.
Do you conduct Holy Communion sometimes for patients?
Yeah, we conduct Holy Communion for patients, and it is done every month, sometimes after 3 months, according to how we have put it in our program.
Spiritually, do you think there is any role that you can do to make sure that people understand this and welcomes the times that we're passing through?
Yeah, I need to have a part whereby I can go and sensitize mainly to the women who are still here at the hospital. As I said, we have more than 300 women who come for their babies.
Yes.
And they are there for a long time, and I'm with them up during the night prayers. So as of now we are using these evening prayers outside. So I still think like we need to train them how they can follow the measures in staying in 2 meters apart, because we are still having such problem. We do it in evening, so whereby it is difficult to maintain the distance.
Any final words to all the members of the hospital and the world as a chaplain or a reverend as we pass through this time?
My last word is that as we are in this pandemic period, I encourage you not to stop worshipping the Lord. And it has come with fear, but we need to believe that God has not given us the spirit of fear, but the spirit of love, the spirit of joy, and the spirit of courage. So let us be courageous as we believe that our Heavenly Father will help us as we still continue maintaining the measures which have been put on. You're
And tell us where we are this time around here.
I am dating Harawa, Mr. Craig, one of the staff in the stores. We are two, but what we do actually is we supply items which are needed in the general hospital. Like this time, as we are in this time of COVID-19, we have some of the materials that are making us prepared for the attack. If ever we may have that case around us, these are the things we have bought for the case. When the case is there, they will rush and collect these things. We have these examination gloves, these are gumboots, and we have the
headgear.
We have the goggles. We have also even the basins we use for the hand wash. We have the taps outside, as you've seen, and some are here. But we also have soap, which we bought only to prepare us for the COVID-19. But they are not even enough, because as you can see, we need some more to help us with the pandemic. But we have also the materials which are for the health center, which is about to open by the name of Engaraweni. So these are the material waiting to go to Engaraweni.
So what do we have here? Do we have?
We have delivery beds. We have mattresses. We have the locker.
The drug box.
The drug box. Mm-hmm. We have the screen. Some of the pieces are at the back.
Okay.
Yeah, but this is the linen for the screen.
Okay. So, as a store's clerk, what challenges do you meet on a daily basis in terms of supplying the needs of the departments?
There is a very big challenge in the stores because there are so many things as a hospital we need to have. But because of financial crisis, some of the materials needed in the hospital are not available because of cash. Always we are running short of cash to buy some materials to help us.
So is that a worry to you as a stores clerk, especially that now we are coming to issues of COVID-19?
Of course, yes, it's a worry to me and even my colleague, because we know if we don't have much supplies to give the hospital, it gives a problem for those who are to see the patients. They can't work properly because they have lack of material and even the COVID-19. I think the nurses, even the clinician, I think they may not be free to assist the patient when he comes because they will be afraid of taking the virus.
Thanks so much.
Lamb of God.
I'm a administrative officer, and as an administrative officer, I'm part responsible for procurement. I'm the IPC chair, that is chairman for the Interior Procurement Committee of the hospital, and transport officer. The hospital is already struggling to source drugs to keep the hospitals. The hospital and the health centers are running. Monthly, we need about $10,000 to run our hospital and health centers, as far as drugs and medical supplies are concerned. It is not easy for us. We mostly rely on credit. As I'm speaking, the hospital hasn't been able to pay for its drugs for some months, and debts are accumulating. So the coronavirus pandemic is adding on the strain that the hospital already has, and it's really a struggle. We therefore call upon partners to help us. In the transport side, our fleet is very old. Our vehicles usually break down. We struggle to take care of our patients, and this pandemic is also adding a burden on the hospital. We have set up a committee to behind our border hospital, and they have decided to fix one of the ambulances, which is old. We have budgeted about $2,400 to fix the ambulance. Because the hospital is busy to combine our daily operations with the coronavirus pandemic activities will be a big hassle. So if you can have a dedicated vehicle to attend to corona issues, that will go a long way towards lifting the burden of the hospital. Thank you.
Oh, say, why?
what do you mean when you say you're a nursing officer?
When I say I'm a nursing officer, I mean I'm a degree holder.
You're a degree holder? Yeah. Okay, so what position do you have at the hospital?
At the hospital, I'm in charge of greater ward.
Okay. So, oh, that's interesting. How many babies do you usually deliver in a month?
Okay, in a month, we deliver almost 200 babies.
Okay. And how many antenatal mothers, like pregnant mothers, do you have on average at the hospital, since you're in charge?
Yes, on average, we usually have 100 mothers per month.
Oh, okay. So on a daily basis, you have 100 mothers as well?
Yes.
And this is your house, right?
Yes.
Do you like it?
Yeah, I love it.
As a degree holder, you like this house?
Yes, I love it.
Okay. How many houses are here? It seems like it's kind of it's a joint house.
Yeah, there are four houses, so we call it a quad.
It's a quad. Okay. The other ones who are in these houses are also nursing officers?
Yes, they're all nursing officers.
Okay. How important is it that you should be here as a nursing officer?
I think it's very important that you should be here as a nursing officer, because one, it's near the hospital. Whenever I'm needed, they can come or they can call and I'll be able to reach the hospital in good time.
Would you take us around inside and just see your house?
Yeah, most welcome.
Thank you so much.
As a result, we really seek for assistance for for well-wishers all over the world. The hospital mainly relies on user fees, which we collect from our patients. And unfortunately enough, our hospital is located in a very remote area, such that their income is very low, and even our charges are on the lower side, so as to cater for our patients, so that they should not suffer in terms of payments. By average, our monthly collection is about 6 million Malawi kwacha, but our expenditure is mostly on the higher side, such that we even buy our drugs on credit. As I'm talking right away now, the hospital is owing our suppliers close to 23 million for debts, for drug debts. This is really a challenge as a hospital to operate using the user fees alone. In this regard, we really wish our partners or well-wishers who could come in and assist us in terms of finances, which we could not manage on our own with the coming of this disease, the pandemic of COVID-19.
Mawichirwa, the senior human resources management officer. As my colleagues have already said, indeed, it is true that this COVID-19 pandemic has greatly affected us to the extent that we need more labor force, especially health workers. However, as a hospital, we are crippled in terms of finances in order for us to hire more health workers in fight for this pandemic. However, it's our plea as a hospital that if maybe the government can help us in terms of finances, even the dollars, I think they can do a great job, because that money will be channeled to the recruitment process of the heavy workers. Even a little amount will also be of great importance, because you can always hire some heavy workers on a temporary basis. Yes, these people will be hired special during this pandemic period. Thank you.
Loudon Mission Station. I think since last year, October. I am here to say that this Loudon Mission Station comprises 11 institutions, including the Embangweni Mission Hospital. And we'd like to thank our partners for the support that they render to the hospital. Also, the support that we render to these institutions which are existing here at the mission station. And let me also take this opportunity to say that I love every other partner, every other donor out there, when they come to this institution, that they also visit production and organization. I should also say that when a person is in the air station, he sits in the chair of the station management committee. this reason, that's why you say people of the year will become this place, living also with the station. We thank the Lord for all the support that we receive here as a mission station, and above all, the support that we receive to the hospital. Because like this time around, in this time of COVID-19, the coronavirus, which is a pandemic of the whole world, which has not spared even Malawi, the hospital is and has put in place several measures so that people are kept safe. And it is in this regard that we are thanking the Lord that partners out there and are supporting the hospital and also supporting the mission in general. So for this reason, I just say thank you, all our partners out there, and we thank the Lord for the fellowship and the unity that exists.
For Embangweni Mission Hospital. I joined this institution on 1st June 2019. As a hospital, we are located in the rural area where social and basic amenities are very scarce. But as Mission Hospital, our aim is to preach, at the same time also to heal in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Since it is located in the rural area, and this being a paying hospital, most patients are unable to pay the full bills that they have incurred at the hospital. But day in, day out, we need resources to run this hospital. For example, we need fuel to ferry patients from our health centers, even referring for patients to the main hospital, which is in Zimba District Hospital. But also looking at our terrain, the road is not always in good shape. Therefore, our vehicles are always in bad shape and they need regular maintenance. But looking at our income, most of these things are not routinely done. Also, considering the fact that we are in the rural area, most of the population, if you talk of literacy level, it is very, very low. Therefore, with the coming in of this COVID-19 disease, the hospital is in an awkward situation, because first and foremost we need to civic educate the community. Therefore, we need to conduct sensitization meetings, trainings, so that people should be able to know the disease later on, be able to prevent how they can be infected. At the same time, as a hospital, we have got members of staff who may also require training so that they should be able to know what COVID-19 is all about. This also needs resources. As a hospital, and considering the fact that it's in the rural area, social amenities like water are a challenge. Therefore, the coming in of COVID-19 is putting the hospital in an awkward position. Because we need hand washing facilities, we need protective wears. Normally, even before the pandemic, we had challenges in procurement of the PPEs. But with this pandemic, it is mandatory that each and every health worker should be protected so that this pandemic should not spread much. But considering the fact that we are challenged in this area, in financial capacity, we are really in need of this support so that we can be able to protect our employees, be able to train our employees, be able to buy equipment. For example, teaching and learning material so that we can reach out to the people whom we are serving at Embangweni. Thank you.
Sister, we see that you are on duty today. What do you know about COVID? Or have you trained in COVID-19?
Not yet, but my turn is tomorrow, so tomorrow that's when I'm going to be trained on COVID-19.
Okay, so you're training tomorrow, right?
Yes.
Okay. And how do you think it is important for you as a nurse to know about COVID-19?
Yeah, this is important to me because I will know on how I'm going to help my patients and also on how I'm going to protect myself and also my patients from this COVID-19. Yeah.
Apart from that, are you ready as a nurse to face this COVID-19?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm very ready.
Okay. The community should be happy that you're going to do this work.
Yes, they should be happy. I'm going to help them.
So what do you mean when you say you mess with ABCD? What do you mean by that?
Okay, what that means is that I am a certain number of the medical students that have come for the MESVET program, which is like a student elective program.
So this program, what actually happens?
Okay, for this program, we get to apply and then we are picked out of hundreds of applications. And when you get to come here, you work in the hospital and you're exposed to patient care and you're exposed to learning from your seniors. So it's a diverse program where you get to work in the hospital and also to learn quite a number of things that maybe we're not exposed to back in the central hospitals.
As a student doctor, how have you found this program?
As a student doctor, I appreciate the program because it's helped me to gain confidence in my patient care and it's helped me to be independent and also to be humble and to ask for help when I need help.
What would you recommend to somebody who has not taken part in this program?
I recommend that they come and join because it's a wonderful experience. You meet really kind people and you're not afraid to ask questions. And they also drill you to shape you into a better doctor, which is a really good experience.
So what benefits do you get out of this program?
Let me say that the benefits we get is that we are exposed to patient care and we are given responsibility and that builds your character as a doctor, it builds your knowledge, and it builds your skills.
Housing?
Oh, yes. And when we come, we are given free accommodation, free electricity, free water, and we are even funded a little allowance every month.
Internet?
Yes, and we get internet.
Okay, thanks so much, huh? Bye-bye, guys.
Zither Harp
Dr. Kondwani, Adamson, Zgambo. I'm 35 years of age, and I've been the director of this hospital for the past 3 years. This is my fourth year. I joined the hospital on the 1st of January, the year of 2017. I'm happily married to Dr. Rita Chipeta, who is working in government. And God blessed us with a handsome son on the 4th of June 2019 by the name of Ukaboni. Ukaboni means testimony, in simple terms. I'm a born again Christian who has also worked and served in various capacities of leadership during my medical school. And I've been heading a Presbyterian church student organization also on campus, but also a Christian Medical and Dental Fellowship, which is a commission of CMDA internationally whilst in college. And the church where I used to go in Blanta, Mount Prison Presbyterian Church, I also served as a coordinator for the Presbyterian Students organization from College of Medicine, as well as the nursing school. This is Kamu's College of Nursing. I was also the HIV coordinator at the church level whilst working was at school in Blanta. And I've also done a number of trainings in line with leadership. Just before I came to work here, we had several seminars as well in leadership whilst in Blanta. But soon after I came to work at Embangweni Mission Hospital, there was an opportunity that I had also to go to China and did a seminar on leadership or hospital management for 3 weeks in Guangzhou, China. And that was in the year 2017, in March. We also had an opportunity to go to Beijing, the capital of China, just to see how our friends are also managing their hospitals there. I've also gone out to just represent the hospital internationally. I was in America in the year 2018, where I made a presentation at Malawi Mission Network Conference in Dallas. And this was an invitation of a church called Prison Hope Presbyterian Church. This church is very important to me because they are the ones supporting me at the time I was in medical school. So it was very important for them to invite me as well to attend this conference in Dallas, Texas in 2018, starting August to September there, and I was joined by my wife. I presented on the topic medicine in Malawi whilst in America. And from there we also traveled to Sparta, Illinois, where we also spent some time and also spoke to the Rotary Clubs there at the invitation of Bob Holloway and a good family as well that has been very supportive under this hospital. From there, we were also invited, me and my wife, to go also and speak unto a church in Virginia, Richmond. We had visited two churches there. We visited our First Presbyterian Church, and where I also took part in the service there. But also visited Westminster Presbyterian Church, where there is Robert, who is key there and who has also been very, very instrumental unto us. Whilst in Lynchburg as well, I had an opportunity to go and visit Roanoke Presbyterian Church. I'm Covenant Presbyterian Church in Roanoke, where we have our sister there, Kathy Slack, who is very key in terms of what we do at this hospital and their support. from Virginia, I had also an opportunity to fly to Colorado, especially in the city of Loveland, at a church called Mount View Presbyterian Church. A church which has also been very supportive unto us, and we have got all our thanks unto Reverend Gary, who is the senior pastor there, and Melissa Joanne, and the key also person there by the name of Richard Keller. From Colorado, I also flew to Oregon. In Oregon, we met two doctors that have also been very supportive under this hospital. And this is Dr. Patel, Shukat Patel, and Dr. Cosmo Stonioro. So they invited me there. I also spoke to the medical school, especially the registrars, telling them about how medicine is done in Malawi, but also what are the challenges that probably are totally different from what they get there. So we had a good time in Covaris, Oregon, in Portland. And recently, in 2019, I was also awarded as a leader that is transformational in nature, a leader that has got a servant leadership, a leader that is so resourceful. And this award came or was done by the CCP Synod of Living Stone here at the event that we held, where we wanted to honor the 2018-2019 Best Awards, our best performance of especially the staff members. So the Synod took me by surprise that they also awarded me. So I thank God. Embangweni Mission Hospital was established in 1902 by the Scottish missionaries, especially a missionary by the name of Donald Fraser, who married a medical doctor by the name of Agnes Fraser. It's very important to the history of this hospital because, you know, Donald Fraser, together with the Ngonis, especially the Inkos and Skuzo, they were together at Kora, and until around 1900, when they decided to move here. Apparently it was Inkos Mzukuzukwan who had come here first and settled around Luasos. And eventually, later on, they decided to also invite Donald Fraser, who had come here. The whole reason why they left in Hora is that in around 1900 also, rockers had destroyed their crops. So they also came this side also in search of a good place. Later on, the river was source, but the water there wasn't all that very good, so they moved up here following the river called Kakoma. So the history has it that the wife of Dr. Donald Fraser, Agnes, had a friend by the name of Mrs. Loudon. Mrs. Loudon was a wife of a doctor, Loudon, and Dr. Loudon was a friend of the missionary Deb Livingstone. And after the husband, Dr. Loudon had died, the wife of Dr. Loudon decided to send money to somebody who is doing missionary work in Africa in honor of her late husband. And that missionary work, to some extent, has to be connected with the hospital. So she heard of Agnes, Dr. Agnes, being here at Loudon together with her husband, Dr. Donald Fraser. Dr. Donald Fraser had a PhD in divinity, and it was not a medical degree. So she linked up with Dr. Agnes Fraser, and she offered a gift of £1,000. And you can imagine, £1,000 in the year 1900, that was going to be a lot of money. It was going to be a very, very big hospital. So when they got the money, Donald Fraser, had an idea of how they would use the money instead of just using it for the hospital. So he said, what if we split the funds? Part of it should be used to set up their school, part of it should be used to set up the church and the hospital. But they could not just go ahead with that decision because it was a donor money. Most pre-donor donor funds come with the regulations. They had to seek for guidance. So Donald Fraser, being a husband, convinced the wife, and they wrote Mrs. Lauda, and they gave her an assurance that if she were to accept that these funds were to be split for whatever purposes that they decided to use, like in this case, the school, the church, and the hospital, they were to name this station Loudon Mission Station. So she said yes when they actually wrote her. This is why this station is called Loudon Mission Station. So in 1902, we started with the place started with a small hospital, or I would say it was more of a hospice where Dr. Agnes Fraser used to treat those that were hurt in the wars, in the Ngonis and other people. But if you see the Mase, the church was established in 1903. That's when they had finished the work of the church, still standing up to date. And the Mase, or the upstairs house where the head of station is housed now, was finished in 1905. The hospital is under CCPC and the Living Estonia, but also under Christian Health Association of Malawi, CHAM in short. And it is a 145-bed hospital. It has also 4 health centers. The 5th one is about to be opened in Embangweni. The first health center, the closest I should say, is at 15 kilometers from us. It's called Mawiri. And the second one is called Muharaunda. It's at 17 kilometers. And then we've got Kalikumbi, which is at 27 kilometers. The furthest is in the district of Kasumu, and it's called Impasa's Health Center. It was established around 1978, thereabout. We are at 50 kilometers from the district of this place, Zimba, in the northern part of Malawi, but also bordering Zambia. It's just 27 kilometers for you to get to Zambia from here at the border. And the M1 road is to our east, and they are 31 kilometers. We're about 125 kilometers from the main city of the northern region, Zuzu. And the occupancy of the hospital is 107%. On average, we see about 60 to 80 patients in the outpatient department, and also we see about 4,000 patients in our health centers where we don't admit. So these are more or less like just outpatients. At the main facility, we admit about 4,000 patients in a year. We have about 100 pregnant mothers who are with us on a daily basis, and we have 250 on average deliveries that happen in a month. Out of these 250 deliveries, 16% are through cesarean section, and the rest are the ones that are born normally. The least ward to have patients is male ward, because mostly patients when they come, when they have the condition is pretty worsened. Seconded by a female ward, where we have an average of around 20 patients. Then a pediatric ward, 25, 30 thereabout. But we have a lot of patients in antenatal ward. We have 211 workers at the main, the whole hospital, and about 150 of these are at the main facility. The rest are in the health centers. And we've got 2 doctors myself and also Dr. Craig, who is heading the clinical department, and we have 8 clinical officers and 30 nurses at the main facility. So this is kind of a picture that we do have at the main facility. On average, as a hospital, we meet issues mostly that are to do with the having expenditure that are more than the income, because we are in the rural setting and people contribute less, which cannot match what we spend on a daily basis. Being in a rural area and having about 21 places where we do outreach clinics, sometimes it becomes very costly for us, and because of that we end up sometimes having difficulties in terms of matching what we get in and what we invest in or use for our daily work. We've relied mostly on what we call service labor agreement, whereby government allows us to help these patients for free, and thereafter we invoice them to get money. But the challenge has been that even for us to get these monies, it has been difficult in the sense that it takes sometimes a bit more time for us to get the monies, and that gives us a problem. As a hospital, where we're coming from was very bad. I remember 3 years ago. We were in huge debt, close to $60,000. But come June last year, we had cleared out the debt. But because of these bumps, whereby sometimes we support a good number of patients and invoice government, and it takes some time, we found ourselves as well. You know, I mean, the debt started kind of getting up again. But we're very thankful because we finished the debt because of various partners that have come to support us. And that has really helped us. Apart from those, there have been also a number of partners that have helped us in terms of changing the face of this hospital. To mention quickly is the Malawi Mission Network, a team from the Netherlands, together with the World Gaze. They've been very, very instrumental in making sure that the hospital gets a new face. So the houses are changing. I mean, the hospital is changing. Like, we've just finished the pediatric ward, very beautiful ward. And now we'll be getting into the operating theater. And this has really been very, very helpful to us as a hospital. So us as the Embangweni Mission Hospital, we went in the relationship with our partner known as Malawi Mission Network team around 2016 when the agreement was signed. The MWT is a Netherlands based organization that does fundraising down there, and then they also link up with World Gives and support us to change the face of this hospital by making sure that the hospital is renovated. As I told you, that we were established in 1902, and you can't expect the structures of those days to still be in good shape by this time around. So LWT is coming in to make sure that the hospital is renovated, upgraded also to a place, to a stage whereby it can live the standards of this time. Mostly I would say beyond even the standards that we do have around the country. If, as you can see, as you've seen, the houses that the MWT has built, has renovated for us, as well as the ward. You know, very beautiful ward. You can't easily find such a ward in the country, especially even in child hospitals, even government hospitals. It's very rare. So we're so thankful for what they're doing, and we're so thankful because what the people of Netherlands are doing, because we know that MMWT is just a group that meets different people of goodwill who, you know, willingly contribute towards this. So we don't take that for granted, and we say thank you. You're making a tremendous difference to the people of Embangweni and people of Malawi. Come 3 years, this hospital will be the best hospital that one will choose to go because of its beauty, cleanliness, you know, and whatever you may name it. And that eventually will make the hospital generate enough funds, which will end up making it possible that it can sustain itself and help the underprivileged of this area. And that's what man is meant to do, to make a difference unto humanity in this world. So we're very thankful to MWT and also very thankful to World Keys. Because so far we started with the staff houses, very beautiful house which was being built. We went again to the staff houses, four of them, where our nursing officers, degree holders, they're so motivated, as you've heard, to get in those houses. Because they can never find such a house in other places, so they'll just choose to be here. And that's what we want, and that's what MWT and World Gives want. On top of that, they're also investing in capacity building to make sure that they don't only construct, but also make sure that people have knowledge. People that are getting into those buildings have the knowledge. So we feel like that is a complete approach, or holistic approach that MWT is doing. So in all departments, you talk of clinical, nursing, you know, chaplaincy, primary health care, it means we are benefiting in that way. So, you know, globally now, we are being affected by the pandemic, in this case called COVID-19. As a hospital, we've also been very much affected because, as you've heard from the administrator, as you've heard from the accountant, you know, I mean, the hospital being in the rural area already struggles to meet its needs in terms of running costs. And COVID-19 has come in with its own demands, already on the pressing or overbearing demands that we've been having with our nurses. And we cannot just do this by ourselves. And this has also made us to shift some attention that we had from the hospital, or what happening in the hospital, to kind of prepare to face COVID-19. For example, I'll take into consideration the Malawi Mission Network, Malawi Mission Work Team, the MWT, and World Gives, which is supporting us. As you can see, the project has now stalled because we are all facing now towards how best we can fight the COVID-19. The people here are already underprivileged. The staff on the ground are already few. And once affected with this pandemic, it means things will get even more worse. This is why a number of things have stalled, because we want to make sure that we face COVID-19. We've set up a task force which is helping us. We've written various proposals to partners, especially, and I'll not forgetting MWT. Some have started responding, and some are yet to respond. One thing we know and believe in that we're serving the people of God, and people have always come, and we believe they will also come to just support us, so that the water problems that we do have should be sorted even before we have a case. That the shortage of staff that we do have has to be sorted before probably we have a case. That people are equipped with knowledge before we even have a case. That we have vehicles maintained so that we can respond accordingly before we get even the case. That the community which we're serving is well equipped with the knowledge. COVID-19 is affecting us as a hospital. We know that sometimes we cannot face this by ourselves. Historically, we failed to get through a number of things by ourselves. But I'm very thankful to God that people have been there for us, like partners, several of them. And we do believe as well that they will also be with us this time around, because some of them have already started responding and some are yet to respond. So we believe that much as we have issues at hand, they'll come along and it will work out very well. And a number of projects now are on hold, like the MWT construction work is on hold just because, the lead team is also stuck in South Africa, like Peter and Esther, who leads the team that does the construction. But at the same time, you can't do the purchase of some materials in the lab shops because of the COVID. The movement is a challenge. So we meant to get into the next project. This is the theatre project. So COVID-19 has shown that we cannot face it with the external workers to come and just be with us. We need more funds to just buy PPEs, personal protective equipment, a good system of water, so that each and every time we should have water around the hospital, which is a problem this time around. Currently, as a hospital, in the proposals, and at the same time, we've also made sure that we put up hand washing facilities, as you can see. And we've also made sure that staff can start getting trained to make sure that they know exactly how to recognize somebody who has got COVID and how they can actually approach such a patient. But also, how to manage the case if at all it gets there. And we've also tried to make sure that we fix one or two vehicles so that in the event that we have a case, we can easily respond. But also buy even ICT material that we can use to teach the community which we serve. And at the same time, we've tried also to fix problems that we do have at our water pumps so that we can have enough water. But also we're proposing to procure enough oxygen concentrators just to make sure that we also prepare accordingly. And we are also writing proposals, which is beyond this, to actually have probably the solar system, because power is an issue here. And sometimes we've lost lives because power has been an issue. We've also gotten into using gensets, generators, because we just wanted to have the hospital operate. So these are the type of efforts that we've put in place just to make sure that we deal with COVID-19. Currently, what we need urgently are funds. Funds that are up to around 15 million to make sure that the project that we do have is achieved fully. The budget that the task force has made and management has approved around 15 million, and we've written this to different partners, especially also the World Kids and MWT. If we have this, I believe in good time, we'll be able also to have a good number of things that we need to make sure that the community is prepared, the hospital is prepared in facing this, apart from some of the effort that we've already started doing. Let me be quick to thank all partners that have already shown interest, and some who have already honored their support. Partners like Medical Benevolence Fund, and also churches in Ireland, Brother Church in Ireland, and also the Mountain View Presbyterian Church in the USA, Colorado, to be specific, Loveland. They've come in already. But we still want more people to actually come in and just support us, because we want to buy the personal protective equipment, but also fix the water problem and maintain the vehicles as quickly as possible. Get these ICT equipment so that we can teach the community and ourselves, and the sensitization especially. But to get especially the PPEs and the drugs that we need to have in place so that in the event we have the case, we can easily, you know, contain the condition. We've also tried to fix to identify an isolation room, and we're also decongesting the guardian shelter. As you can see, it's fully packed to get into the old administration and to get into the old pediatric ward, just to make sure that we have few of them at that time. At the same time, we've also linked up with the government so that we can make sure that we see these pregnant women from their respective areas, unless there are issues that they can be at the hospital. So we've taken the 2 weekers not to be the time when they can come, so that we increase the time that they are home. But we've tried also to make sure that we interact with them through our outreach clinics, so that we can reduce the number of them at the main facility. And you know that can come with problems. So we put in measures to have enough humor and maintain that also, that in the event of anything, we can quickly go there and respond to whatever problem that might be there. At this point, you know, any help of any sort is welcome, and from anywhere, in any way, because we just need to join hands. No one person can manage to handle all this. We need collective effort, and it's my call as the director of the hospital to say, let anybody wake up and do a difference that to the humanity out there. You know what I mean? Because no one else can do this. So any sort of support, it's going to be welcome at this stage, so that we can save this community. So as a hospital, what we've also done is to make sure that every person should wake up. So we've instructed the Department of Administration that they should also make sure that they put in measures that will make sure that we address the problems. They send them into nursing, clinical, as well as even the laboratory, where we know that this is going to be very, very helpful in terms of managing issues that will be happening this time around. Technical staff, supporting staff, and everybody in short, we put in measures to make sure that all of us are geared up into facing this COVID-19. In case we have a case. So we believe this is going to be very helpful, and it's a collective effort. If you go around, you find that different people have knowledge of what they can do and see that what we can do, that eventually we should have, probably avoid having a case at our facility. Thank you.